All right. Now I plan to end the parables next week. We'll see. So I may talk kind of fast, but I think I'll be able to do that. And then the next week after that, Lord willing, we'll begin a short study of Proverbs. And then it's not clear to me yet what's going to be happening in the next quarter in terms of my teaching. So when that becomes clearer to me, I will let you know about that. Now we're looking at parables that I've grouped under the title. There's an interesting line jumping through here, at least here. Living as kingdom participants, and more specifically, we're looking at the parables I put under living as kingdom participants, specifically with regard to money. And when I was so rudely interrupted by the bell last week, we just started looking at the parable of the unjust steward in Luke chapter 16, verses 1 to 9. Now, I will quickly read the parable again, and then I will repeat a bit of what I said at the end of the last class, and then we'll move on from there. So it says, this is Jesus says, he also said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. And he called him and said to him, what is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager. And the manager said to himself, what shall I do since my master is taking the management away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig and I'm ashamed to beg. I've decided what to do so that when I am removed from management, people may receive me into their houses. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he said to the first, how much do you owe my master? He said, 100 baths, or ESV says measures, of oil. He said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, and how much do you owe? He said, 100 cores, or measures of wheat. He said to him, take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. Now, as I said last week, the manager is an agent of the owner, somebody who acts with the owner's authority. And the debtors, they're probably people with whom the owner had contracted to farm his land, and they owed him and would give him a portion of the produce in return. And the owner is satisfied from reports that the manager is incompetent. The manager is wasting his possessions, and he fires the manager and demands that the manager wrap up things by giving an accounting of his management so that the owner, when the new manager comes in, he knows where he stands and what the record of things is. And the manager cheats the owner. He cheats him by reducing what the debtors owe the owner. And he does that to ingratiate himself with the debtors, so that when he then is actually out, he's then done a big favor for these guys, and they will then receive him into their place. So that's what he's doing. He's planning for his future. He's doing it by cheating the owner, but he's planning for his future. Now, the reductions that the manager makes, they're quite substantial. 100 baths, or ESV says measures of oil, that would be about 800 or 900 gallons, which would be equivalent to about 3 years of wages for an average worker. And he cuts that in half. And then 100 cores, or measures of wheat, would be nearly 1,100 bushels of wheat, which would be about 7.5 years of wages for an average worker. And he reduces that by a fifth. So what that means is that he gives both debtors the same total discount. Both of those debtors that are reported get a discount of about 1.5 years worth of wages. So that's what he's doing there. Now, some people argue, because they don't like the idea of the owner praising the dishonest or unrighteous manager. Well, they argue that, well, he didn't really cheat the owner. That wasn't what he was doing. What he was really doing was he was removing the amount of unlawful or illegal interest that the owner had charged these people. So he was really doing a solid. He was taking, that's what he was doing. And that really doesn't work, because the interest rates from this period of time are known, And what you see, the reductions he makes, they don't fit with that. They don't fit with that at all. So no one reading this or hearing this would think that interest was involved. And another idea that people bring up, they say, well, no, what he was doing was he was removing his own inflated commission. That's what it was, is that he had charged a large commission, and what he was doing is simply eliminating his own commission. Well, if he was charging commissions like that, there's no reason to think he would have been destitute. I mean, he would have been fat city if he was charging commissions like that. But besides that, it's doubtful that his commission would be listed in a statement of what was owed to the owner. And I think these are attempts to try to get around what I think is a non-problem. And perhaps most important in terms of those attempts, there's just nothing in the text to indicate that the reductions are illegal interest or the reductions are a commission. The reference to the manager in verse 8 as dishonest or unrighteous, that pretty much lets you know that he's cheating the owner. And the fact that in verse 6 he urges the first debtor to change the amount, what, quickly? Why do you think he wants him to do it quickly? He wants him to change it quickly so nobody will see what he's doing. See, he's clearly cheating the owner. That's what he's doing. Now, in the real world, the manager would have been punished for this calculated fraud. Okay, there's no question in the real world that would have happened, but parables need not track reality at all points. That's just not how parables function. The owner in the parable praises the manager despite the injustice or the wrongness of his conduct. He praises the manager for the limited reason that he'd acted quickly and shrewdly to ensure his own future. That's what he's focusing on. He's not condoning his methods, only his having taken effective action. It's something like what we mean in our phrase, giving the devil his due. Now, you know what's conveyed by that, right? You're not saying that you agree with what was done or the method, but you're acknowledging that there is something about what was done that you can see, okay, no, I don't think he should have bribed or cheated or done that, but I do see he was effective in getting his political results. You see, something like that. So that's what's going on here. Now, in verse 8, the second part of verse 8, Jesus, he gives the significance of the parable. In the second part of 8, he says, for the sons of this world, literally he says, for the sons of this age, for the sons of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. Now the manager, he is a son of this age, and as such he's distinguished from the sons of light, who implicitly are not of this age. They're not of this age because they participate in the new age. The sons of light are not sons of this age because they participate in the new age that is breaking in Christ's inauguration of the kingdom. Back to the introduction that we spent weeks on. You see that the new age, the age to come, the consummated kingdom is breaking into the present through Christ inaugurating the kingdom. The sons of light are sons of the new age. They are not sons of the present age, sons of the old age, sons of the world. So the manager represents the sons of the old age. The sons of the light are the sons of the new age. As Daryl Bach comments, he says, in pointing to the children of this age, there's an inherent comparison with God's children as the children of the age to come. So this is what you're getting. The children of this age, the children of the world, and the children of light, the children of the age to come. And that's the contrast there. And the point is that the sons of this age, those who are represented by the shrewd manager, they know how to operate in their arena, the world, for their future benefit, better than the sons of the new age know how to operate in their arena, the kingdom, for their future benefit. The praise of the sons of this age, the praise of the sons of this world, it functions as a criticism of the sons of the light for their relative ignorance regarding how to live in keeping with the age to which they belong. So he says, these guys are either sons of this old age, the sons of the world. They really have it wired on how to operate in the world of which they're a part, the age of which they're a part. You sons of the kingdom are relatively ignorant about how to act so as to secure your future benefit. And so you have this implicit criticism. Here's what how Joel Green, he says this in his commentary on Luke. Children of this age, Jesus observes, understand how the world works and use it to their benefit. Why do children of the light, this went out, not understand the ways of the kingdom of God? That's what you're getting here. That's the contrast. And that's why in verse 9 he exhorts them. This the very next verse he says, and I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. See, it is a call to live in accordance with the ethics of the kingdom by being generous with one's wealth. That's what he's calling that. That's why I've grouped it here. It is a call to live consistently with the calling of God, with the ethics of the kingdom, by using your wealth in the way God calls you to use it. That's what he wants them to do. Now, when he speaks of unrighteous wealth, as it's translated in the English Standard Version, this is mammon of unrighteousness, and mammon is an Aramaic term that means possessions or money. And the phrase mammon of unrighteousness, it probably means money that tends to corrupt or leads to unrighteousness, money that is so easily put to wrong use. And that may be what's intended in translations like the NIV and the New English Translation when they translate it worldly wealth. It is dangerous. I've said before, the Bible has so much to say about how you use your wealth. And we don't like to really talk about it because we're afraid it will make us look like we're money grubbers and we're so interested in money and that we really just want you to give to the congregation and that's all we're about. So we tend to shy away from it, but this is about people as disciples living as God would have us live, and a large part of that, or a significant part of it, is how we manage and use the wealth with which he's entrusted us. Do we use it as stewards of his? And that's what he's talking to them about here. Robert Stein, in his commentary on Luke, he notes that the phrase, when it fails, which is oftentimes translated, and I think misleadingly, as when it is gone. I don't think that's what he means when he says when it fails. Rather, I think, as Stein says in his commentary, when it fails, quote, refers to the final day when the possessions of this world and the world itself come to an end, not when one goes broke like the prodigal son. He's talking about the consummation and the ending of wealth itself. It's the time of wealth's end that's alluded to. For example, in James chapter 5, verses 1 through 3, where he says, come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You've laid up treasures in the last days. It's this idea that at that time, at that judgment, wealth will fail in that it will cease to be significant at all. It will just be gone. There won't be a thing like wealth. You see, and I think that's what he's saying. So he says, look, you need to live in such a way, and you need to be faithful people in terms of how you use the wealth that has been entrusted to you so that they will receive you into eternal dwellings. You say, well, who are they? Who are they? Well, they who will receive you could refer to the faithful poor. You have helped through your discipleship, through your being a steward of the wealth God has blessed you with, you have then used that to help them. It could be the faithful poor who have been received by God ahead of you, but more probably it refers to angels as representatives of God. Angels as representatives of God. Klein Snodgrass, in his book, Stories with Intent, he paraphrases the meaning of verse 9, where it says, "And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into eternal dwellings." He says, put yourself in good position through your use of money, which so easily leads you astray. It has a big pull. It is easy to become self-centered and selfish with regard to wealth. He said, which so easily leads you astray, so that when this age is over, when it fails in that sense, when it fails in the James 5 sense, so that when this age is over, God will receive you into his eternal dwelling. In other words, be faithful to God. Here, specifically speaking about with regard to your use of wealth. But be a person of true faith, a person of genuine faith. Be a disciple of Jesus Christ, so that through that discipleship and that surrender to Jesus, what do? You manage your wealth as the Lord calls you to. Just as you do all kinds of other things in discipleship. Be faithful to God. Here, speaking specifically about wealth. Why? Because wealth is a danger. It is a blessing. Many good things can come from it, but it is a danger. And so he's telling them here, be faithful to God in your use of wealth, in the use of the wealth with which he blesses you. Have a genuine faith that expresses itself in deeds. As I've said many times, a genuine faith that expresses itself in deeds, here in the deed of using your wealth as a steward. Have a genuine faith that expresses itself in deeds, and you will receive the blessings that accompany faith. That's what I think this is about, where he's saying, listen, this is important how we do this. The third and final one under specifically with regard to money is the rich man and Lazarus. So you see, Luke has an obvious interest in this. Do you see? Here is Luke, who makes sure that he reports the parables of the rich fool, the unjust steward, and the rich man and Lazarus. And that's why sometimes when you may run across a book like The Theology of Luke, and you're going like, what in the world is that? I mean, Luke's just, he's an inspired writer. What do you mean, The Theology of Luke? Well, it's these kinds of things, you see. The gospel writers themselves take different perspectives and different emphases on things. And so here you'd see somebody, for instance, who was doing a theology of Luke. They would want to draw out Luke's concern that we be stewards in his sensitivity to the poor. You see? So it's a little footnote. You may not care about that. Okay. The parable of the rich man and Lazarus. It occurs only in Luke 16, 19 to 31. And he says, keeps blinking off. There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And let me read up here. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, the realm of the dead, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame. But Abraham said, Child, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he's comforted here, and you're in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us. And he said, Then I beg you, Father, to send to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. He said to him, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. Now, people sometimes wonder whether this is a parable or the recounting of an actual event, but virtually all modern scholars agree that it's a parable. Indeed, Snodgrass is unaware of any modern scholar who would deny that it's a parable. Though it's obscured in many English translations, the parable begins with the phrase, a certain man. See, that's not always reproduced in English translations, but it begins with that phrase, a certain man, which is how Jesus introduces a number of undisputed parables in the Gospel of Luke. You have the Good Samaritan, the barren fig tree, the great feast, the lost prodigal, or the prodigal son, the unjust steward, the parable of the minas. All of those undisputed parables introduced with this idea, a certain man. And you have that very same thing here. So the idea is, is it a parable? Yes, it's a parable. See, and it's true that this is the only one of Jesus' parables in which he names some of the characters. There's nothing about parables that means characters cannot be named. Yes, this is the only one where he names them, but in parables you can name characters. In fact, so the fact that characters usually don't have names doesn't mean they cannot have names, and there are a number of examples of Jewish parables, as Craig Keener points out, where some of the characters are named. So you can't go, well, he identifies Lazarus here, so therefore it's a real thing. No, you can't do that. You see, it's something here that's a parable. In fact, it is interesting in that regard. You notice that Lazarus, the name Lazarus, it's a Greek form of Eliezer. And the meaning of that name is he whom God has helped. So you can see, okay, we've got the characters and their name like that. But in any event, that's a question that comes up sometimes. You know where I stand on it. It's a parable. All right, now, the contrast in the parable is between the fate of this rich man who lived in great luxury. The fate of the rich man who lived in great luxury and the fate of Lazarus, a poor, disabled, physically suffering, and starving fellow Jew who was laid at the rich man's front gate, no doubt by relatives hoping to incite the rich man's compassion. So here is this pitiful person, physically disabled. The guy's just pitiful, sores on him. And his family's taking him and putting him at the front gate of this guy who's got like all kinds of money. Just living in tremendous luxury. Hoping to incite his compassion to take care of this suffering fellow Jew. And day after day, the rich man just, pardon me. Let me just crawl over you on the way to my feast. He's longing to eat what falls off the guy's table. He's like my dog. That's how hungry he is. He would do whatever, longing for what falls off his table. You see? But that's how we are. He doesn't have compassion. And after death, Lazarus is in a blessed state in the realm of the dead, this intermediate state between death and resurrection. The resurrection has not occurred. Life is still going on earth. This is a portrait of the intermediate state between death and resurrection. But here he is, you have Lazarus is in a blessed realm of the dead, whereas the rich man is tormented. He's tormented in that state, and in the far distance he sees Abraham and Lazarus together, and in his flaming agony. This isn't a good picture. This is not a good picture. In his flaming agony, he calls out to Abraham to have pity on him, to send Lazarus to dip his tip of his finger in cool water, come and cool his tongue. And however symbolically, like I say this about hell, the eternal torment of the final judgment, however symbolically one takes the suffering of the unbelievers in the intermediate state, it's bad. What do you think's being portrayed here? It's bad. He says, look at this. Would you just send him there to cool my tongue? So the rich man is reminded, you see, that in his lifetime, The disparity of circumstances between him and Lazarus didn't trouble him at all. There was a tremendous disparity of circumstances. Here's this guy who's physically disabled, poor, starving to death, sitting there, and here you are on the other end of the spectrum. Good times are rolling. You're in purple and eating all kinds of stuff. That disparity then didn't bother you at all. Didn't give you any concern, trouble you at all. In fact, he chose to maintain that disparity by refusing to do anything to ease Lazarus's suffering. And his present agony is a consequence of that choice. He opted to maximize his comfort, his luxury, at the expense of heeding God's command to be compassionate toward the needy. He said, in essence, I don't care what God wants me to do. Yes, God has said, care for those among you. And he walked over this person day after day and said, frankly, I don't care what God wants. I want to have more leg of lamb or whatever he's eating. I want to have this. It's like that old Daffy Duck cartoon. Mine, 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 mine. See, that's how he looked, went after it. And so that's the choice he made. He chose money over God. And that's a dangerous temptation. Deuteronomy 15, 7 to 8. If among you one of your brothers should become poor in any of your towns within your land that the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not harden your heart or shut your hand against your poor brother, but you shall open your hand to him and lend him sufficient for his need, whatever it may be. Isaiah 58, law, prophet. Isaiah 58, 6 and 7. Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover him and not to hide yourself from your own flesh? Your fellow Israelite? And so this, what's happening with this guy? This guy says, I choose money over God. I choose me. I don't care about God. I don't care what he wants. He can go pound sand. You cannot make that choice in your life and think that when you die, you're going to be received by God. He wants you to receive him, but he wants you to receive him now. And then he will receive you. You see, you can't live that way. You can't make those choices. Snodgrass comments on the parable. He says, the fact the rich man wants his brothers to repent, it's in verse 30, shows that he recognizes his own error. Surely his judgment is based on the injustice of the juxtaposition of his wealth and Lazarus's poverty and his neglect to do anything about it. The rich man's error is precisely that of those on the left in the parable of the sheep and the goats. Neglect of the poor and those in need. Only in Hades does the rich man raise his eyes to see. Back. But even there, his concern is only for his own kind, his brothers. The parable forces the understanding that Lazarus, the child of Abraham, was also his brother and should have been the object of his concern. So this is the idea. This is what is going on. Now the rich man, he's also told that his request for mercy is now impossible to heed. He's told that. The two realities in the intermediate state of the dead are separated by an impassable chasm. There are no relocations after death. There's no movement between the two places. There is this place of suffering and sorrow and torment and blessing at the bosom of Abraham. And there's no passing back and forth. It's not after death. Well, hey, I think I'll just, then I'll cross on over. Nope. That's not happening. This is Jesus telling you this. That's not something that's happening. The choice we make in this life with regard to God's revolution, God's call. Jesus has come and he's inaugurated the kingdom and he has said, fall in behind me. Come, pledge allegiance to me. Come, follow me. And we who have come and followed him, that's it. So that's the call, that's the choice. And the choice that we make with regard to that revolution is final. It is final. One will either be blessed beyond measure in the intermediate state, which is what is symbolized by being there with Abraham, and then in the consummated kingdom. You see, so we'd be blessed in the intermediate state, in the disembodied existence awaiting the resurrection. That's blessed. So those of you who've had people die, loved ones die in the faith as Christians, will be at peace. They're in a blessed state. That blessed state will be fulfilled in their final permanent assignment in the resurrection, where they will then enter into the eternal glory. You see, of the new heavens and new earth. So you have this idea, the choices that we make now regarding God's revolution have these permanent after death consequences. Blessedness now and in the eternal state, or hardship and suffering now, or followed by damnation in the eternal state. So there's no bigger question. There's no bigger issue. So I always say, and then we in our society and culture, we talk about things like the Kardashians. And I'm thinking, what's going on with us? We talk about the shallowest, most trivial things that are front and center, and here we have these kinds of issues. But if you try to talk about those, of course, I know who's behind all this. You see, you try to talk about those, well, that's just, that's all old kind of whatever. But this is what matters. This is what matters. Now, the rich man then asked Abraham to send Lazarus to his five brothers to warn them so they will repent before it's too late and thus avoid his fate. And the implication, you see, of that is that his warning had been inadequate. That's the implication, you see. If you will send them to warn my brothers, then they will avoid the mistake I made. If only I had had an adequate warning, you see. That's what's going on. That's the implication there. See, that's what he wants to remedy in the case of the brothers. He wants to remedy his not having an adequate warning by sending Lazarus, which he's claiming that would be an adequate warning, unlike the warning I got. So if you will send him to warn my brothers, so that will be sufficient to provoke them to repentance, and therefore they will avoid the fate that I'm in. You see, when it says repentance, he understands what he was doing. You see, that would be sufficient to avoid that. See, but Abraham rejects this plea of ignorance. Refusing to send Lazarus, instead he says, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. What are you talking about? They have Moses and the prophets. I just read Deuteronomy and Isaiah, and you could read many more. It's not like it's, you don't have a secret decoder ring. I mean, it's just plain. He says, this is how you're to be. If you're following me, if you're committed to me, this is how you're to live. And so he says, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. As I just pointed out, you have those Old Testament texts, and there are many other passages that could be cited. The rich man and his brothers are without excuse. They had the scriptures, but what did they choose to do? They chose to ignore the scriptures. I don't know what rationale they used. They said, how do you know that's from God? Blah, blah. Where is he lately? What's he done? How do you know? Do you believe in him? I haven't seen him around. I don't know how they did it. But you tell me, in our culture, are there people that are rejecting and ignoring the Word of God? Yes. Well, he said they have them. They chose to ignore them. It's not a matter of the adequacy of the warning. Well, the rich man doesn't like that reply. And he argues, look, that if somebody like Lazarus returned from the dead, that would have a much greater impact than the Old Testament. And after all, the Old Testament, it hadn't been adequate enough to warn him. So if you would up the game, if you will give us some kind of special revelation like that, that will be sufficient. See, he reasons that if there were some visible demonstration of the afterlife in the form of a resurrection, he would have acted otherwise. If I had only known that I was actually going to be in this position, that I couldn't get out of. If I had known that this was a reality, if you had sent somebody who was raised from the dead, who could then say, by the way, trust me, there is a reality that's coming. Oh, if I'd have known that, then I too would have repented and would have avoided this place. And Abraham rejects the claim that the problem with the rich man and his brothers is a lack of evidence. He says, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone rises from the dead. You see, the problem is not the quantity or quality of the evidence. It's their unwillingness to hear the word of God. That's how it is. You either hear the word of God and you treat it like the word of God and you say, this is God expressing himself, or you blow it off. Yeah, well, yeah, it's not that. It's, you know, and there, you know, there are all kinds of ways that's done. And that's what these people are winding up doing. It wasn't a lack of evidence, but their unwillingness to hear the word of God. And that unwillingness will cause them to ignore or explain away some extra or special revelation, just as they ignored or explained away the revelation of the word of God. That revelation is perfectly clear. It's not the evidence. There it is. They take it. They hear it. They blow it off. And he says that hardness of heart that causes them to do that will cause them to rationalize and explain away even if someone rises from the dead. Now, what happened when Jesus rose from the dead? There you have it. Does the Lord know or does the Lord know? See, does he know? Sure. He knows. You see, that's what happened even after he rose. Many Jews, including the Pharisees, whom Luke labels, by the way, lovers of money in Luke 16, 14, they refused to join his revolution with its commitment to the poor. He rose from the dead. Just send somebody back from the dead and they will repent and they won't wind up here. Jesus rose from the dead and he went back and he taught his disciples and all, and they're out here telling everybody this is what happened. And what do they do? I don't know that he rose from the dead. What are you seeing? You're seeing how the hardness of heart trumps the evidence, because there are ways always of, that's how this world is structured. There are ways of skinning things that if I don't want to believe something, I'm left with the ability to skin the evidence in a certain way that I can justify my unbelief. You say, why did God do that? Well, we can ask him when we see him face to face. You see, but I can understand why. Same reason he didn't suck all the air out of the earth and say, you're going to believe me. For the next 30 seconds, you'll have no air. Do you get it? Could he force you to believe? Yes. But he set this place up so there is just the distance, the epistemological distance that he wants. There is ample evidence and proof of who he is, what the truth is. And you can believe it or not, but don't tell me. I don't believe because of the evidence. I'm just an intellect. Spare me that. You see? Just spare me that. It's an issue of the heart. And that's what he's getting at right here. It's not lack of evidence. It's an issue of the heart. You see, now Jesus didn't abolish the Old Testament's concern for the poor, by the way. You see that, right? He authoritatively expressed the heart of the Old Testament teaching about compassion for the needy. And so here are these Pharisees, for instance, who love money, and he says, fall in behind me. Now, though this is a parable, I hope you can tell that I think one is justified in drawing from this parable certain truths about one's state after death. I understand it's a parable. Sometimes you say that, people say, well, you can't know anything about the afterlife from a parable. Okay, I understand what people are saying about that, but I think you can draw certain things from this. The main point of the story is to warn people of the danger of rejecting kingdom ethics. In this case, the ethic of concern for the needy. So here is Jesus. He is warning people of the danger of rejecting God's ethical concern for the poor and needy. That's why he's telling this. See? That to do that is to reject God. To reject God's kingdom ethics is to reject God. Do you see that? If God says, I'm God and I call you to be these kinds of people and to live this way in my name, and you say, I'm not going to do it. Well, do you see how they're connected? So Jesus is calling people here. He's warning them about the danger of rejecting kingdom ethics, because that is a rejection of God. And he indicates to his hearers, this warning he's giving them is that they would face irreversible conscious torment if they rejected God's will, kingdom ethics, during their lives. So he's warning them by means of this parable that they will face irreversible conscious torment. Now, contrary to what some people say, well, there are people who say, no, you're not going to be conscious. You see, you won't be conscious. But I don't see how Jesus could warn people by means of a threat that was untrue. How would he be warning them of the danger of neglecting and rejecting kingdom ethics by a threat that you will have irreversible conscious torment if that's not true? Now, I guess somebody could say, well, wait a minute. It's possible, right, that his parable showing irreversible conscious torment, that's hyperbole. Okay, I'm all for hyperbole in the right place. It's possible that's hyperbole, see, to dramatize the horror of unconscious existence. You say, okay, so you're saying unconscious existence is just really a horrible, horrible thing. And to dramatize the horror of that, he has a parable where he depicts irreversible conscious torment. I guess that's possible, but the problem I have is I don't know how any first century Jew would understand that. You see, how would a first century Jew understand that? Because among the beliefs about the afterlife in first century Judaism was the belief that the spirits of the ungodly were tormented and the spirits of the godly were blessed in the period between death and the final judgment, the resurrection. So given that that's part of the background of Judaism in the first century, how would somebody think that? If Jesus then portrays that and threatens them with irreversible conscious torment, and that comports with part of the theological structure of Judaism, how is somebody who's hearing him going to think, oh yeah, that's hyperbolic, rather than something that's consistent with the theology of Judaism? I just don't see how that could work. Okay, so I believe you can glean certain things from this about the afterlife. And a couple of those things is, one, there are two divisions, and one's a bummer, and one's glorious. Now, there is a future resurrection when those things will be eternalized. Those assignments will be eternalized in resurrection existence. They will be eternal glory with God in the new heavens and new earth, and they will be damnation and final condemnation. So that's, I think you can glean those things, and I just mentioned that because sometimes you do that and people say, well, you're overreading the parable. I understand that idea. I think it's fair to draw those things from the parable. I'm going to have to really talk fast next week. I got two parables. You think that's not many, but the second one takes a lot of setup if you're going to get what I'm trying to say about it. But thank you for coming.